I'm Professor Von Schmohawk, and welcome to Why You. So far, we have seen how complex numbers can be added, subtracted, and multiplied. In this lecture, we will see how complex numbers can also be divided, where the dividend and the divisor may each contain a real part and/or an imaginary part. The result of this division will be a complex quotient that may also contain a real part and an imaginary part. We will also see how the vector representation of the quotient is geometrically related to the vectors of the dividend and the divisor. As a general example, let's call the dividend z1, the divisor z2, and the quotient z3. In the previous lecture, we introduced two parameters that describe the direction and length of a complex number's vector representation. The first parameter, called the argument of the complex number, describes the vector's direction and is defined as the angle of the vector from the positive real axis. The argument of a complex number is written as arg, followed by the complex number in parentheses. The second parameter, called the absolute value or modulus of the complex number, describes the vector's length defined as the distance from the origin to the point representing the number on the complex plane. The modulus of a complex number is written as that number enclosed in a pair of vertical bars, in the same way that the absolute value of a real number is written. We also said that when two complex numbers are multiplied, their arguments are added, and their moduli are multiplied. So by adding the arguments of two complex numbers and multiplying their moduli, we produce the modulus and argument of their product, which we will call z1. So when we multiply two complex numbers, z2 and z3, producing the product z1, the modulus of z1 will be equal to the product of the moduli of z2 and z3. And the argument of z1 will be equal to the sum of the arguments of z2 and z3. We can also use these relationships to derive the relationship between the vectors of divided complex numbers and their quotient. To derive the vector relationships for complex division, we divide both sides of the first equation by z2 and divide both sides of the second equation by the modulus of z2. Likewise, in the third equation, we subtract the argument of z2 from both sides. So this tells us that when we divide a complex number z1 by another complex number z2, producing the quotient z3, the modulus of the quotient will be equal to the modulus of z1 divided by the modulus of z2, and the argument of the quotient will be equal to the argument of z1 minus the argument of z2. Now that we know how the lengths and angles of the vectors in complex division are related, let's try a simple division example, dividing the complex number -8 plus I by 2. Even though this fraction is a valid representation of the quotient, We would like it to be written as a complex number in standard form. Standard form complex numbers are written as a plus bi, where a and b are real numbers and are called the real part and the imaginary part. In this example, the quotient is easily separated into its real and imaginary parts. Once both parts have been simplified, the result of this division is a complex number in standard form. So dividing the complex number negative 8 plus I by 2 produces the quotient negative 4 plus 1/2 I. Now let's see what this complex division looks like when we view these numbers as vectors. When we divide negative 8 plus I by 2, we get the quotient negative 4 plus 1/2 I. So let's see how this agrees with the vector relationships we just derived for complex division. In this example, z1 is negative 8 plus I, z2 is 2, and the quotient z3 is negative 4 plus 1/2 I. The equation we derived for the moduli tells us that the length of the quotients vector z3 should equal the length of vector z1 divided by the length of vector z2. Since the length of vector z2 is 2, dividing vector z1 by 2 should produce a vector 1/2 its length pointing in the same direction, which was the result that was produced. Likewise, the equation we derived for the arguments tells us that the angle of vector z3 should equal the angle of vector z1 minus the angle of vector z2, which is 0. And since the angle of vector z2 is 0, the angles of z1 and z3 should be equal, which is the result that was produced. In this last example, we divided the complex number negative 8 plus I by 2. Since the divisor 2 was a real number, this fraction was easy to separate into the sum of a real part and an imaginary part. However, this process can become more complicated when the divisor is a complex number with both a real part and an imaginary part. To see why, let's divide negative 8 plus I by the complex number 2 plus 3i. When we separate this fraction into two fractions with the same denominators as we did in the previous example, both fractions still contain a mixture of real and imaginary numbers. However, if we can convert this fraction into an equivalent fraction whose denominator is a real number, then we will be able to split this fraction into the sum of a real part and an imaginary part, as we did in the previous example. This can be accomplished by creating the complex conjugate of the denominator. A complex conjugate is easy to create, since it is done by simply changing the sign of its imaginary term. So the complex conjugate of the denominator 2 plus 3i is 2 minus 3i. Now, an important property of complex conjugates is that when a complex number is multiplied by its complex conjugate, the product will always be a real number. For example, let's use the distributive property to multiply 2 plus 3i by its complex conjugate 2 minus 3i. 2 times 2 is 4. 2 times negative 3i is negative 6i. 3i times 2 is 6i, and 3i times negative 3i is negative 9i squared. And since I squared is negative 1, negative 9i squared is negative 9 times negative 1, or positive 9. Adding these results, negative 6i plus 6i is 0, leaving 4 plus 9, or 13. So as in the example we have just seen, multiplying any complex number by its complex conjugate always produces a real number. The reason for this is easy to see when we view this process in vector form. When we take any complex number and multiply it by its complex conjugate, we add their arguments. But since the arguments of the complex number and its complex conjugate have the same magnitude but opposite signs, their sum is always zero. Therefore, the product of a complex number and its complex conjugate always has an argument of zero. The product's vector will therefore lie on the real axis and represent a real number. Since multiplying a complex number by its complex conjugate produces a real number, we can use this property to convert a fraction with a complex denominator into an equivalent fraction with a real denominator. That fraction can then be easily separated into its real and imaginary parts. To change this complex fraction into an equivalent fraction with a real denominator, we start by multiplying the denominator by its complex conjugate. However, we must also multiply the numerator by the same number so that the value of the fraction remains unchanged. Starting with the denominator, we have already seen that 2 plus 3i times its complex conjugate 2 minus 3i is 13. So now let's multiply the terms in the numerator. Negative 8 times 2 is negative 16. Negative 8 times negative 3i is 24i. I times 2 is 2i. And I times negative 3i is negative 3i squared. And since I squared is negative 1, negative 3i squared is 3. Adding these results, 24i plus 2i is 26i. And negative 16 plus 3 is negative 13. So the numerator of our result is negative 13 plus 26i. Now that we have produced an equivalent fraction whose denominator is a real number, it is easily separated into the sum of a real fraction and an imaginary fraction. Simplifying the fractions, negative 13 thirteenths is negative 1, and 26 thirteenths is 2. So negative 8 plus I divided by 2 plus 3i is negative 1 plus 2i. In this lecture, we have seen that when a complex number containing both a real and an imaginary part is divided by a real number, we first create a fraction with the complex number as the numerator and the real number as the denominator, and then split this fraction into its real and imaginary parts. On the other hand, when a complex number is divided by another complex number containing both a real and an imaginary part, we first multiply the top and bottom of the fraction by the complex conjugate of the denominator giving us an equivalent fraction that can then be separated into its real and imaginary parts. Now that we can perform all four arithmetic operations, addition, subtraction, multiplication, and division with complex numbers, we will see how complex numbers can be used in complex functions in the same way that real numbers are used in real functions.